Welcome everyone. In the previous videos, we have discussed the microwave diodes, simple microwave devices. Now we are going to discuss microwave transistor as another type for microwave devices. And generally speaking, microwave transistors can be classified mainly in two types. Bipolar junction transistors and field effect transistors. For bipolar junction transistor, there is a specific type of bipolar junction transistors which is called heterojunction bipolar transistor. And this heterojunction bipolar transistor is quite useful for high frequency and microwave applications. Bipolar junction transistor in general is useful starting from low frequency and even in power transistors. On the other hand, field effect transistors in microwave can be classified into three types, mainly metal semiconductor field effect transistors, which can be abbreviated as MESFET, metal ME, semiconductor S, field effect transistor FET, MESFET. The other type, which is a common type of field effect transistor, which is metal oxide field effect transistor, which is abbreviated as MOSFET. Sorry, this should be MOSFET, MOSFET. And finally, the third type is high electron mobility transistor, which is abbreviated as HEMT, H-E-M-T. So we have three types from field effect transistors, and bipolar junction transistor with a specific type, heterojunction bipolar transistor. In this video and in the following videos, we are going to discuss briefly these types of microwave transistors. As a beginning, we are going to start with bipolar junction transistor. As I said, our lectures are based on the textbook of microwave engineering by Bozar. However, the point of microwave devices can be discussed in more details in specific textbooks. So, for example, for bipolar junction transistor, there is a specialized textbook for bipolar junction transistor, which is High Frequency Bipolar Transistors, Physics, Modeling and Applications by Rich. This was published by Springer at 2003. This textbook is a good reference if you are interested to know more data about bipolar junction transistor in microwave applications. But following up the textbook of Bozar, we are going to discuss what has been mentioned in the textbook of microwave engineering. As a beginning, we start with the construction of the bipolar junction transistor. Almost all of us know that the bipolar junction transistor can be NPN or PNP. For microwave applications and RF applications, it would be more useful to use NPN, because in NPN, the major carrier is the electrons, and usually the electrons have higher mobility, and higher mobility indicates that the speed of the electron inside the transistor is large. And if the speed is large, it means that it can be useful for high frequency. So usually the bipolar junction transistors for RF and microwave applications are NPN, and it is very rare to use PNP as a bipolar junction transistor for RF and microwave. So basically we have the emitter N as a fork like this, and this fork is printed on a B substrate like this. So the interaction here between the emitter and the B will introduce the junction NB. And to conduct the base, which is B, we are going to use B plus fork shape like this as a terminal for the base. Effectively, the role of this fork B is that this base or this fork is connected to a metal wire. If we are going to use a metal wire or a metal connection directly on the base, we are going to introduce a Schottky diode between the metal and the base. So, to avoid this Schottky effect, we are not going to connect metal directly to the base with B concentration. But instead, we are going to use B plus concentration. Such B plus concentration will not introduce a Schottky effect between the metal and B plus. And this B plus will be connected to the base of B. So the graduation of the concentration of the holes from metal to B plus to B will make us avoiding a Schottky effect between the metal contact and the B base. On the other hand, for the N emitter, the N semiconductor, when it is connected to a conductor to metal, it will not introduce a Schottky effect because the majority at the conductor is electrons and the majority at the N base or the N, the N semiconductor is electrons too. So there is no difference in the majority of the carriers between the metal and the N semiconductor. Then after the base is held at a substrate of N, and this substrate of N type it would represent the collector. Effectively, the main parameter in the design of the bipolar junction transistor is the spacing between the interdigit between the emitter and the base and the length of the base junction. This is the base, this length of the base where the carrier is going from the emitter passing through the base to the collector. This length is the main parameter which determines the cutoff frequency of this bipolar junction transistor. So, if you are interested in designing a high frequency bipolar junction transistor, it is required to reduce the length of the base as much as possible, such that the carriers will jump from the emitter inside the base to the collector in a very small time period. In this case, we can use the transistor at higher frequency. But the disadvantage of reducing the length of the base, which is this dimension, is that the maximum power of this microwave transistor will be reduced because the maximum power is inversely proportional to the thickness of the substrate. So we have two options. Either to increase the power so the base or the base length is increased, or increase the frequency so the base length would be decreased. So in microwave transistor, the base length is decreased and the total microwave power or the total power is decreased. So we say that the construction of a typical silicon bipolar junction transistor having multiple fingers of base and emitter electrodes like this. And effectively, here we have just simple two fingers for the emitter and three fingers for the base. Actually, the number of the fingers can be increased. For example, we may have 5 fingers for the emitters and 6 fingers for the base. But this is the simplest situation. The bipolar junction transistor is current driven. It means that it is controlled by the current of the base. So, with the base current modulating the collector current. So, the current at the collector is modulated by the amplitude of the current at the base. The other frequency limit of the bipolar junction transistor is controlled primarily by the base length. This is the base length, which is typically of the order of 0.1 micrometer. So, as we decrease the base length, we can increase the operating frequency. RF bipolar junction transistors are usually made using silicon, and effectively bipolar junction transistor is one of the oldest and most popular active RF devices in use today because of its low cost, good operating performance in terms of frequency range, power capacity, and noise characteristics. Bipolar junction transistors are useful for amplifiers up to range 2 to 10 GHz and in oscillators up to 20 GHz. Bipolar junction transistors are sometimes preferred over field effect transistors at frequencies below or about 2 to 4 GHz because a bipolar junction transistor at this frequency range have higher gain and lower cost, and with the possibility of biasing with single power supply. But the field effect transistor at this frequency range, at low frequency range from 2 to 4 GHz, would have higher cost, and it may require 2 power supply for biasing, and also the gain of the field effect transistor in this frequency, in this low frequency range, it would be less than the bipolar junction transistor. However, the main disadvantage of bipolar junction transistor is the noise, because effectively the mechanism of the current through the bipolar junction transistor is the motion of a carrier, electron carriers, from majority at the emitter to minority at the base, then add to majority at the collector. At the base, this interaction between the electrons and hole, this interaction will introduce some sort of noise. So, bipolar transistors are subject to short noise as well as thermal noise effect. So, their noise figure is not as good as in the field effect transistor. We will see in a following video, in the field effect transistor, the carrier of the current is the same type all in the gate. So, in the field effect transistor, the carrier is moving from majority to minority, from minority to majority once again. This will introduce some sort of short noise and thermal noise effect. So, the main disadvantage of the bipolar junction transistor compared with the field effect transistor, the bipolar junction transistor has noise figure greater than the field effect transistor, or has a noise effect greater than, or noise temperature greater than the field effect transistor. But from the point of view of the power at lower frequency, the bipolar junction transistor is much better than the field effect transistor. The small signal equivalent circuit for bipolar junction transistor, usually in RF and microwave circuits, we are using common emitter transistor. So, we have the input port is the base and the output port is the collector. In this case, we have what we are calling the bi model. The bi model, from the base, we have the dynamic resistance RB and R bi and the capacitance of the base emitter junction C by, and the capacitance of the collector, or the capacitance from the emitter to the collector CC, and the equivalent current source, which is driven by the current from the base at the collector, which is the transconductance GM multiplied by the voltage at, or the dynamic voltage at the base V1. Effectively, this model does not include the parasitic resistance and inductance due to the base and emitter leads. So actually, we have here the resistance of the lead of the base, the inductance of the lead of the base, also we have the resistance and the inductance of the lead of the collector on the other side, and in a similar way for the emitter lead. In many cases, the capacitor CC between the base and the collector in the hybrid bi model has relatively small value and it may be ignored, being that this capacitance is very small and we can ignore it. If we ignore it, it means that the collector is not directly connected to the base. And actually, the current at the collector is controlled by the current at the base by the transconductance GM. But in this case, the base is not connected to the collector by any way. So if we have a certain signal at the collector, this signal will not be transferred to the base, because the transconductance is one directional. It is coming from the base to the collector, but is not going from the collector to the base. So in this case, if the capacitance between the base and the collector is ignored, we are saying that this device is unilateral. Unilateral, it means that the signal is going from 1 to 2, but there is no signal is going from 2 to 1. Or in other words, the S parameter S12, the signal at 1 due to the signal at 2, is nearly 0. This means that the power only flows in one direction from the base to the collector and does not flow from the collector to the base. And from, or this configuration is defined as unilateral. So the device in this case is called to be unilateral. So generally speaking, S12 is not purely zero, but if we have very small S12, this means that the device is nearly unilateral. The upper frequency limit of the bipolar junction transistor is determined by frequency called the threshold frequency. At the threshold frequency, the current gain of this two port network is unity. So if we assume that the input current is I input at the base, and ignoring the series resistance RB and the shunt resistance RY, so the current passing through the input port here will correspond that the voltage at the base, the dynamic voltage or the AC voltage at the base, it would be the current multiplied by the reactance of this capacitor, which is 1 over G omega C. So 1 over G omega C. So the voltage at the base, V by, is the input current multiplied by 1 over G omega C. In this case, the output current at the collector for short circuit, the output current, if we put short circuit at the output, so the total current, it would be GM multiplied by V bar. So the output current would be GM multiplied by V bar, because this is the current source and we don't have any bars except this short circuit. So the short circuit current gain, in this case, the short circuit current gain is I output over I input. It would be GM multiplied by V by, which is I output, over I input, which is G omega C, G omega C by multiplied by V by. So GM V by over G omega C by V by. So the magnitude of the short circuit current gain, it would be GM over omega C by. Now, the condition for the upper frequency limit is that the frequency at which the short circuit current gain of the transistor is unique. So, to obtain the threshold frequency or the maximum operating frequency of this transistor, we are going to equate the short current gain by unity. In this case, the value of omega would be 2 pi multiplied by the threshold frequency. So, the threshold frequency, according to this, put this 2 pi multiplied by the threshold frequency, Ft, and this is unity. So, Ft, it would be Gm over 2 pi multiplied by C pi, or the pi capacitance. So, the current gain is seen to decrease at the frequency and is unity at the threshold frequency. The threshold frequency equals the transconductance of the transistor, Gm, over 2 pi multiplied by the pi capacitance C pi. This is the maximum frequency which we can use this transistor as an amplifier. So, depending on the value of C pi and the transconductance, we can determine the cutoff frequency or the threshold frequency of this microwave transistor. It should be noted that this pi model or small signal pi model for the bipolar transistor has some limits. This limit is that the hybrid pi limit, hybrid pi model is roughly based on the physics of the junction transistor and can be useful to circumstances where the element values of the model are fairly constant over a range of operating bias condition, load condition, and the frequency. This means that for a specific biasing and specific load and specific frequency, we can obtain this bi model. But if we have change anything of this, we have different bi model. So, actually, this bi model has very narrow band accuracy. So, otherwise, the element values become frequency bias or load dependent. So, in this case, the hybrid bi model becomes much less useful. So, instead of using hybrid bi model to model the microwave transistor, we are going to model the microwave transistor by its equivalent S parameters. And we are going to measure the S parameters for the biased microwave transistor at specific biasing condition with a specific biasing network. And according to these S parameters, we can introduce the design of the microwave circuit by the S parameter design. So, actually, in microwave circuits, we are not depending on the equivalent bi model as in low frequency circuits, but we are mainly depending on the S parameters, which are usually measured directly. It is not a model which is measured directly for the transistor. So, in the following video, we are going to discuss how to bias the microwave transistor and how to measure the S parameter with specific biasing conditions. And from this S parameters, in the following chapter, we are going to discuss how to use this S parameters to design microwave amplifier, for example. So, see you in the next video to see how to measure the S parameters of the bipolar junction transistors and how to use this S parameters and what is the expected value of this S parameters. This is what we are going to see in the following video.